Alright, good morning everybody. How are you feeling? It's the morning when I'm recording it. I don't know what time you're watching this, but right now the sun is out, the leaves are blowing, and it looks like a gorgeous day outside. Maybe things are getting better. All I know is I'm golfing Friday, so that's good. My first time out this year. So, we're finishing up the year, and it's been a crazy one, and I appreciate your guys' hard work. And those of you that took the AP test, I hope you did well. And thank you for all your work. Now, the AP exam had eliminated a couple normal requirements, but they are part of the curriculum. We're going to cover those requirements in three lessons. And it's going to deal with area and volume and using integrals to figure out area and volumes of shapes. All right, here's how it's going to go. I'm going to send you this as a document. It's going to be just like a handout in class. It'll be blank. If you'd like to print it out, follow it along, do notes, up to you, whatever you feel like. I'm also going to be sending you this file after I've written on it. So I'm going to send you completed notes. You're going to get a file of blank notes, a file with completed notes, and of course this video lesson. And you go from there. Each of these sections, I'm going to give you just a couple practice problems to try. Not many. See, there's five here. I want you to know how to do this stuff. Do I care if you're an expert at this and you've mastered it? Not really. I just want you to know how to do it because you'll be doing it again when you take Calc 2, if you're taking Calc 2. All right. If you're not, if you're done with math, you're all set. But this is something that will be going over in a typical Calc 2 class in college. And if you take Calc 2 or Calc BC next year and Roper, then we'll be doing it again. So whatever you feel like. The test for this I've already completed is 12 questions. So instead of waiting until we got done, I'm going to post it as soon as I post this first lesson. I'm going to post it, but it's not going to be due till June 5th. So suggestions, wait till we're done with the three lessons. Make sure you get the stuff, take the test, go through it, do it, great. After we get done with area, maybe you go through the test, find all the questions that are just area. You just do those, do them as we go, up to you. Third option, you're tired of me. Which is fine, because I'm tired of me sometimes too. My kids are. And then look up how to do the stuff online. Look it up. Research it yourself. Get it done. As long as you get that assessment to me by June 5th, that's all good. All right. Okay. Well, let's go then. Let me teach you how to do area between two curves. All right. I have a little graph here. Let's say I took a function, something like that. We'll call it f. And I wanted to find the area of that function between two values. We typically call these values a and b as the intervals. All right? So I'm looking for this. You know how we do that. Area was an integral. We went from a to b of the function of f. That's how we do area under a curve. Now, what if I introduce a second function? Let's say I do a function that looks like this. Okay. We'll call this function g. So now I'm not looking for the area all the way to the axis. I'm looking for the area from here to here. Is that how we figure that out? Okay. It's the same idea. Okay. But think about this. Wouldn't all of this be the area of f? Okay. And then wouldn't everything underneath this orange line be the area of g? So aren't I taking away the area of g? I'm just going to get rid of it. So between curves, the only thing that changes in our formula is that we have our function of f subtract our function of g. Now I'm going to throw these absolute values on there. The reason is, and here's a really nice part about this, Let's say you are doing a problem and you got the functions switched, you got them backwards. What would that do to your answer? Well, your answer would just be negative, but wouldn't be the same area. So my calc teacher in high school told me great advice that I've tell every class I've ever taught. If you're doing area between curves and you put a function and another function, you subtract them, and you put it in the calculator, or you calculate it and you get an answer of that's negative, just make it positive. Make your answers positive, because area is always positive. So your book defines it like this. They threw the absolute values on it, so guess what? It's always going to be positive anyway. All right, let's take this idea and let's go. The area is going to be the integral of the two functions being subtracted together. Now, the way I see them, the way I always do it, is if I drew, they call this a representing rectangle. It's not really a rectangle, it's a line, but it's supposed to be a rectangle. Can you kind of see how it's perpendicular to the x-axis and how it hits these two graphs? The blue graph is always on top. The orange graph is always on the bottom. So the blue graph is g of x, which is 3x plus 4. Subtracting the orange graph, which is x squared. I'll put the absolute values on it, but I know it's going to become positive because I have the top minus the bottom. So I know it's going to be a positive answer. What about my limits of integration? Now, sometimes they're given to you. Often they're given to you. But sometimes you got to figure them out. Now, I don't care how you figure these out. You can pop this on your calculator, find the intersection points. You can go to Desmos on the computer, pop them in, look at your intersection points. You can do it the old-fashioned way. You can say, when does x squared equal 3x plus 4? Because those are the two functions. And then, you know, just do a little factoring. Subtract. And this is x minus 4, x plus 1, which means our two x values are negative 1 and 4. That's all you got to do. And once you get this, I don't care how you figure out the answer. You can do it by hand if you feel like, but as far as I'm concerned, you don't have to figure out anything by hand anymore because you're home. You can use your calculator, you can use a computer website, whatever you feel like. I used a website and I got my answer to be 125 over 6. It's kind of cool. It gave it to me as a fraction, so I don't know what the decimal is. But I don't care if you put it in as a decimal or as a fraction. It's totally up to you. Okay? All right. That's how you do it. Top minus bottom. Now, of course, I'm going to throw some curveballs in there because, you know, that's what I do. But let's see what this one so far. So notice how the 2x squared, this graph, is always on top. The x to the fourth minus 2x squared is always on the bottom. So this little area here, where is x going to go? Well, we already got negative 2 to 2. So from negative 2 to 2, our top function, which would be 2x squared, minus our bottom function, which would be x to the fourth minus 2x squared, and we'll take the absolute value just in case I got them backwards, which I know I didn't, but that's okay. It never hurts to be safe. Okay. Now some of you might be saying, hey look, these two are exactly the same. Could you, if you wanted to, just go between 0 and 2 and double it? That's probably what I would do if I was actually doing it by hand. But if I'm typing in the calculator, the only change would be I'll put a negative 2 instead of a 0. So this would be correct, but it's up to you. You don't need to. That's right. I put this into my calculator. Now my computer. I put it into a website called, I searched Integral Calculator. I think it was called Symbolab. And it just gave me this. It was easy to type it into. I'll show it to you. I typed an integral calculator and Symbolab was the first one that popped up. It's actually the one I use most often. The reason I like it, if you haven't seen this one before, it tells you step by step how to do them and they give you the answer. So it's really great, definite or indefinite. All right, so I don't need short-term health insurance. All right, so really all you have to do is type in what you've got. So we got negative 2 to 2. All right, and we'll do the 2x squared, that function, minus the other function, which was x to the fourth minus 2x squared. Whoops, that's not good. How would I do? There we go. And we're going to do that with respect to x. So we've got to make sure to put dx. And just hit go. And if you feel like it, when it comes up with the answer, it will show you exactly the steps that it takes to solve and all that fun stuff. But it will just come right out there and tell you, hey, there's my answer right there of 128 over 15. All right, you can see how I use that program. It was actually pretty easy to type into. So if you like to use that website. Otherwise, use your calculator. Otherwise, do it by hand. Don't do it by hand. Whatever you want to do. Oh, we got three parts. Now, this one, we actually have to do three parts separately, because notice how the top function is not always the same graph. In this little section here, the top function is the line. So we're going to have to do it where we do it piece by piece. This one's a pain because there's a, it's not hard to set up, but there's a lot to set up. So if you actually do it out and calculate it, it's a pain. It takes you a couple, maybe a minute longer than you'd hope. Anyway, the x value goes from negative 2 to negative 1. In this particular case, the line is the top function. So it's negative x plus 2 minus the parabola, which is, 4 minus x squared? Just all things. Just be careful of your negatives and all that stuff. Make sure you put these in parentheses and absolute value to, just to double check. Plus. Now you see how it changes in here. The top function between negative 1 and 2, the top function is the 4 minus x squared. The bottom function is negative x plus 2. And lastly, switching over again, now between 2 and 3, the top function is the line, and the bottom function is the parabola. So you just put all that together. Now when I put it into that little program I just showed you, I got the answer of 49/6. Okay. Now, let's see. Check this one out. We've been thinking about area being top to bottom. Well, there's a problem now. This graph right here, it's the same graph. I can't subtract a graph from itself or function from itself. It ends up being zero if I actually did that, as a calculation. So what I want you to think about is, could this be rotated? If it's rotated, do you see the top and the bottom now? That this graph, this curve is always above this graph. Okay? Now I'm gonna put this back, because sometimes instead of taking the derivative with respect to x, you can take it with respect to y. Notice how if I drew the line sideways, do you see how that purple line there is the difference between this function and this function? Now I drew it at the vertex. You don't have to. Any purple line that goes perpendicular to the y-axis, okay, this function, which is 12y squared minus y cubed, is the top function. And the bottom function would be this. That the distance between these two functions is that line. And that's what we want for the area. Now, the good rule of thumb, if your distance between the two functions is perpendicular to an axis, that is what you have to put the formula in terms of. So if it's perpendicular to the y-axis, they have to be in terms of y. Well, guess what? They are in terms of y. We're going to have 12y squared minus 12y cubed. minus this one, which is 2y squared minus 2y. With respect to y, just in case we got it backwards, we'll take the absolute value, and the y values go from 0 up to negative, I'm sorry, 0 up to 1. It's kind of look at the whole thing sideways, okay? And you just plug that in the calculator. Now, in your calculator, you can always use y's instead of x's. That's totally up to you. Or you can just put an x in place of a y. It doesn't matter. You're just calculating something. This is all said and done. This answer is just 4/3. All right? Area between curves. You've kind of hit it all. Sometimes you do it with x. Sometimes you do it with y. Sometimes you got to break it up. Here's a problem you can do both ways. So we're going to do it both ways. Let's look at the distance if we perpendicular to the x-axis. So that's the ones we've been doing, perpendicular to x-axis. Everything has to be in terms of x. All right, but notice how at this point right here, it switches. So the area between 0 and 1 is the x squared function minus, well, technically, it's the axis itself, which has the equation of 0. So you don't have to put x squared minus 0, but I'm just going to for this particular demonstration. But that's the area of the first one. Now notice, after the dotted line, with my representing rectangle perpendicular to my x-axis, the distance between here, okay, between 1 and 2, is this line. Now, because it's perpendicular to the x-axis, everything has to be in terms of x. So if I take x plus y equals 2, and I put it in terms of x, okay, y equals 2 minus x. Technically, again, minus the bottom, which is 0. All right, that's what you got to figure out. You figure out that one, and you get the answer of 5/6 total. This one's 1/3, this one's 1/2. But together it's 5/6. I want to show you another way to do the same problem. So now the same problem, boom. What if we looked at it from this perspective? Where I looked at it perpendicular to the y-axis. Well, notice how this line, every time I do a line perpendicular to the y-axis, it's always this straight line minus this curve. That means I can do it with one shot. I need to break it up into two parts. It's always this minus this. Remember, if you can't think about it, turn it sideways. Let me turn it to you sideways real fast. Take all this and turn it sideways and see if it all works for me. Nope, didn't quite. I was afraid of that. We'll just turn this one sideways. It was kind of cool though, wasn't it? So if I turn that sideways, you notice how the line is on top and the parabola is on the bottom. That's all we're doing there. Okay. But if it's perpendicular to the y-axis, it all has to be in terms of y. Well, the problem is, this is y equals x squared. That's in terms of x. Well, if I solve this for x, what do I get? Doesn't x equal the square root of y? Right. And this x plus y equals 2. What if I put it in terms of x? Well, wouldn't that be 2 minus y? Okay. So going this direction, right, the outer function, the one that is furthest away, is the line, which would be 2 minus y, minus the one that's closer to the axis, which is x squared. Oh, it's x squared, but in terms of y, it's square root of y. Almost made that mistake. You know what? I'm gonna put absolute values there. All right, and now where does the Y travel from? The Y itself travels from 0 to 1. Now, you put that into a calculator or into a website or anything like that, you're going to get the same thing of 5/6. I know it because I've already done it. I know it works out. I was very confident because I've been doing this for a long time. So that, ladies and gentlemen, is area between curves. I'm just going to do two more since we got them. What if it doesn't have a graph? All right, well, that's kind of an ugly graph, but I want to show you really quickly. How can we go to Desmos? All right, I'm on the Desmos.com website. I really like this for a lot of reasons. One of them is this. You don't have to solve the equation for x or y. You can just type what you've got. And it will graph it, just like that. We'll do the other one. X plus 2y squared equals 3. Boom, and there's the other graph. I love it. And you know the great thing is? 1, 2, those are your intersection points. That's what we need right there. All right, now that we saw that, here is your graph from Desmos. Okay. And you're going to notice that the distance between the two graphs is a line that's perpendicular to the y-axis. Perpendicular to y means we put things in terms of y, or we set it equal to x. So this equation, and that's the nice way they did it, set equal to x, you just add y squared to both sides, okay? This equation, you just subtract 2y squared from both sides. So these are our two equations we're going to use. Y squared and 3 minus 2y squared. All right, here we go. The area is going to equal between negative 1 and 1, because those are our y values, negative 1 and 1. The absolute value, that we don't worry about putting it in the right order, because, you know, sometimes I just mess up that way. This graph here, the blue graph, which should be 3 minus 2y squared. As I say, I'm not really concerned about it, because if it's not right, it doesn't matter. Minus the red graph, which is y squared dy. That's how you set it up. And interestingly enough, this area actually has the whole number of 4. All right. Last one. X equals y squared, y equals negative x. You can graph this if you want, or if you kind of know what it looks like, you can do that too. Or you know what? You don't even need necessarily a picture. I think it helps, but everything looks like it's in terms of x, which is good. X goes from 0 to 3. X squared minus negative x. And you know what? We don't even care which one is top or bottom, because if we take the absolute value, it's going to work out anyway. And it's 27 over 2. If you need the visual, that's okay. Go ahead and graph it. Because remember, if you have the visual, you've got x squared. You've got the line y equals negative x. So you're going to have this area here to work on between 0 and 3. All right, guys, that's area between curves. Now, if you get that down, on Monday, not Monday, because we don't have school Monday technically, Tuesday of next week, I'll be giving you the next lesson, which is volume, which is taking these shapes and spinning them sometimes to create a three-dimensional shape. It's a little trickier in the brain, but the concepts and ideas are exactly the same. So I hope you have a great weekend, and I may see you online Thursday if you decide to join in and ask questions about this. Otherwise, have a great Memorial Day. And I will talk to you guys afterwards. Alrighty, bye.